Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of From the Field Q&A with P&J. My name is Pedro.
And I am John. Let's get into some questions that we've received this past week. Pedro, yeah. I know that you love starting off these things, so why don't you ask the first question?
Well, this week we have a lot of questions from people around languages and localization and regions. So I think most of the questions we've put together for this week are around that, centered around that, the app translations, the content translations, everything. So let's dive into it. The first question is, can you have different default languages for different users in the system? Ooh, that's very cool.
Yes, this is a simple setting in the user's account. You can see on this screen share that I recorded earlier today that if you go into a specific user, down near the bottom of the page, you can set the default language for that specific user. Again, this is just for the app interface itself. It's not for the content, but when that user logs in, they will see whatever language is their default.
And I believe you could do that per user or per role, right? Even if it's a role level, you can go in and set that role.
You know, if you have 100 users, you could have, well, I mean, we have 58 languages in the system right now, so theoretically you could have 58, but we can add more as we discussed, I think, in a previous video. So,
sweet.
Yes, as many users as you have, they can all have different default languages. So,
cool.
Good. We'll go on to the next one, another language question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you support the ability to fall back to a secondary language? For example, if French isn't updated, then fall back to the default for that user.
So yes, any non-localized or missing translations for a specific user language will default to the project's default language.
All right.
Oh, next right. Next one. So does your platform allow locale-based permissions? So for example, a French translator role with access only to French and the source language.
Yeah, so if any of you out there watching have ever seen a demo from our sales engineer, Jonathan, this is his favorite thing to show off. I've actually gone back and recreated it because I've seen it 500 times. But yeah, you can have specific users. So let's say in this screen recording, for example, we're setting up a French translator. You can go in and you can have them see the base language, which in this scenario, we've set it to English, and then the language that they're translating to, which is French. So you can have them see those languages. And on the editing side, on the content updating side, you can have them only able to update French. So they can see the English, they can translate it, but they can't touch the English. So you can set up this for any language, any sort of content translator that you may have on hand or on your team. But it is easily set upable.
I like this one. Yeah, that's a new one.
It works. Whatever. all right. Next question. We'll follow up here. How do editors trigger translations? So that kind of follows into this question. How do editors trigger translations?
Right. So there are a lot of ways to do this. Administrators and developers could use the Directus flows, the SDK, the APIs to integrate with external translation services. That's actually really cool to automate that. Flows support manual trigger options for single or multiple items. So for example, you could implement a flow that, you know, when a base language is filled in and saved, you send an API call to an AI translation service somewhere out there of your choosing. There's plenty of those services available. Have it translated and then send back via the API to input into the translation field. So it's like automatic AI powered translations. And then you could have that flow send a notification or email to an actual translator. That's another option. And that record is ready for translation at that point. So the short answer is, yeah, lots of ways to do it, but I think the flows is kind of the coolest way. Automate it.
Yeah, I think flows in general, a lot of you in the comments in some of these videos have been asking about flows, and I know that we're putting out videos some at a time. We've got this flows cookbook coming. So flows is something that I love doing. I love workflow automations. I love taking things off of my plate. So, you know, not that we suggest it, but I think flows is the most fun way to do it. So.
And so for our last question, is there a way to see if content has been translated? So I'm imagining the question is probably pointing to, you know, if we have a piece of content, how many languages has it been translated to, and maybe the status of if that's in progress to be translated. I think that's what we're getting at, right, John?
Yeah, I would assume, let's say, either if you're using an AI translator or a manual person translating, have they filled in all the information to have that content translated? So one of the nice things about Directus is that out of the box, it comes with this content translation view, this layout, where you can see those side-by-side languages. But in those layouts, you also have a drop-down that you can see here on the screen recording. you can see how much of each language has been translated. So however many boxes you're translating, there's, you know, gray for nothing, red needs more translation, green all the way to the end means that that language has been fully translated. So there is a nice overview of that and a way to see if all of your content has been edited.
Nice.
So
I'm glad we have a screen share for that one, because explaining it verbally is a little bit more difficult than just showing makes it very simple.
Right. I mean, plus then you can put that screen over our faces, which it's great to hear us all the time, but people want to see it in action, and it's great to actually see it in action. When we're showing these things off every week, people are amazed by this. You know, there's a lot of people who use it who use different languages and translations. We have multinational companies using this. So the interface is really useful, and it's a really useful way to see what has been translated. So we've gotten that question a lot, but
thank you for watching this week. We've actually heard a lot of feedback from you on YouTube, from our Discord, from our GitHub. So please continue that feedback as we continue to create these videos, and we'll continue to improve them based on your questions. So, you know, hop into our Discord, hop into our GitHub, contribute to the community, and we will see you next time.
And like and subscribe.
Oh, always like and subscribe.
Yeah. All right. Bye, y'all.